Oh, wait. I've got my mic. What's going on, my party people? We got Booba Brickton, how 100, August 3rd, 2024. Who? Chick Chick Boom, Apple, Alibi, and Femininimi. So, yeah, let's get into the video.
Hey there. I'm Mark, in affiliation with Spectrum Pulse. And finally, cool down week. And this, it's Billboard Breakdown. Look, there's a part of me that struggles to categorize any sense of normalcy on the Hot 100 these days. I've just seen too much, especially this year. But when we get the expected reset to a relative normal, with the charts slowing down because we're midway through the summer, and thus some of the post-album bomb effects feel a bit diminished, it might be a fair reading, at least for now. We might have some stability. At least for a bit. Because you know what, if we're looking for a place where things seem to have actually settled, even more than I would expect, it's in our top 10, where for yet another week, a bar song Tipsy by Shaboozy has held.
I didn't expect this to have so many weeks at number one, no? I mean, it's only been like, what, two weeks? I think it was three. I'm not 100% sure.
The number one. And for once,
how many weeks
at another
say?
Week, a bar song Tipsy by Shaboozy has held the number one. And for once, I would say it looks stronger than ever. The
My
sales
baby
are great. It retook the top spot on streaming, and it's chasing down that top spot on the radio. Unless we get a major threat or a surge of momentum for something from out of nowhere.
Vultures 2! Sure Vultures 2, let's go!
Immediately is gonna threaten it. Now compare this to I Had Some Help by Post Malone featuring Morgan Wallen at number two. Yes, it's got the top spot on the radio, but it looks like it may have peaked or at least gotten very close. And while its streaming is very stable, it's not making up any ground there, and the sales are down. Now that's a similar case for Not Like Us by Kendrick Lamar at number three, which still has great streaming, but just got overtaken. And the radio growth is just not good enough in order to fill in that gap. Then
obviously,
we got Million Dollar Baby by Tommy Richmond stranded at number four.
This song
where it
like
has
still
stable
exists
streaming,
or?
But it's now losing radio. And it's not like Espresso by Sabrina Carpenter is making up the gap at number five, because while her streaming and radio
she's
were
so bad.
Up a bit, there is just not enough motion there. Although, if this trend continues, she might make some modest positional gains. We will have to see. What actually surprised me was Too Sweet by Hozier had a rise to number six. Yeah, it had a good streaming week, but the radio is now slipping into free fall.
You guys think he actually, like, was, like, just, like, they made him, like, lay in dirt? Do you think that, like, they made him, like, roll around in dirt just for the cover?
Rise to number six. Yeah, it had a good streaming week, but the radio is now slipping into free fall. But apparently it was enough to beat out.
Did they release an album, or they're... Yeah, wait, they did release... Yeah, they released an album.
Streaming week, but the radio is now slipping into free fall. But apparently
yeah,
it was enough
that
to beat out Please Please
Too
Please
Sweet
by
came
Sabrina
out with
Carpenter
the album,
number
right?
seven,
I think.
Which is making radio gains in order to compensate for losses on sales, just not fast enough. Now, what's more notable is that the streaming position is solid, but her actual numbers saw the downturn, which is why she had a loss of position. Then we got Lose Control by Teddy Swim. Holding at number eight despite consistently losing, only holding that edge because Beautiful Things by Benson Boone is losing even faster at a sharper margin at number nine. But finally, breaking back into the top
ten,
we got Good Luck Babe by Chapel Roan at number 10. Streaming is up, sales are up, but most importantly, the radio is starting to get a proper clue who the hell she is, which means that she's got momentum there and about damn time too. I would argue her pop sound is built to do very well on the radio if they just give her a proper chance. Hopefully this is a harbinger of things to come. Now on the flip side, let's get to our losers and dropouts. Look, it's pretty much just Zach Bryan and Eminem album bomb cuts taking the fall, nothing really major, which is all the more true when it comes to our losers, where the vast majority are just from Eminem. Somebody Save Me with Jelly Roll at 48, Toby with Big Sean and Babytron at 57, Fuel with Jid at 65, Habits with White Gold at 76, Renaissance at 82, and Brand New Dance at 90.
Okay.
The only exception here is We Ride by Brian Martin at 89, and that song looks like it's on its way out anyway.
Nah, I forgot that existed.
And that means, for once, we actually have a lot of new returns and gains, and which I prefer to talk about than the bigger losses because it might provide some context as to what could be coming up next. Well, okay, I say that, but the returns, they're not exactly illuminating. Outside of Lithonia by Childish Gambino returning thanks to his
He's
album
Now at 69, now.
We got a mostly scattered collection of songs at the very bottom of the Hot 100. Belong Together by Mark Amber at 84, Okay by JT at 85, Cowboys Cry 2 by Kelsey Ballerini and Noah Kahn at 91, Outskirts by Sam Hunt at 97, Wine and Whiskey by Tucker Wetmore at 98, and After Hours by Kehlani at 99. But nearly a full third of the Hot 100 picked up gains, so let's focus on the only continued boost coming for I Can Do It With a Broken Heart by Taylor Swift at 31. It's a big single push.
Surely one day we release a video for this?
Not surprising. One day. And then we get the losers that rebound.
I feel like that would be like the thing to really push it up.
33, Lovin' On Me by Jack Harlow at 37. Yeah, Glow by Glorilla at 40. Gotta Only by Floyd Menner and Chris MJ at 41. Dirt Sheet by Cody Johnson at 45. Band for Band by Central C and Lil Baby at 51. The Boy Is Mine by Ariana Grande up yet again at 54. Nights Like This by Kid Laroi at 60. Nasty by Tinashe at 62. Sweet Dreams by Cole Wetzel at 74. And I Think I'm In Love With You by Chris Stapleton and Dua Lipa at 80. Now, of course, Chapel Roan also falls in this territory, but she saw larger gains overall, with Red Wine Supernova rebounding to 47, but also Hot To Go at 26, Pink Pony Club up to 50, and Casual at 79. And let's focus on country next, because they're largely going to be stable and rebounding more on position than any overall surge. Ain't No Love in Oklahoma by Luke Combs up to 13, maybe the exception, not sure I could chalk all this up to
13? What the hell? I don't even remember what the song... Wait, I kind of do, actually. I can't remember what the song is.
But it is doing
I'll be lying
well.
If I said
Bulletproof
that.
By Nate Smith at 42.
Forgot that song
Wind Up
existed.
Missing You by Tucker Wetmore at
Forgot
70.
That song existed.
Chevrolet
Forgot
by Dustin Lynch and Jelly Roll at 75.
Existed. Oh, wait, no. That was the one with the sample.
You by even if I barely even want to call
song.
That last one country. Now, finally, the rest from the bottom up. Si No Quieres No by Luis Conriquez and Neton Vega at 78. Scared to Start by Michael Marchegi at 73. The Door by Teddy Swims at 67.
What a creative cover.
Type Shit by Future, Metro Boomin, Travis Scott, and Playboi Carti at 63. 360 by Charlie XCX at 55. There'll be more to talk around this one later. Kalani by Jordan Adetunje at 52.
Wait, why?
Stargazing by Miles Smith at
44. Oh, the new Charlie XCX song?
Mamushi by Megan Thee Stallion and Yuki Chiba at 36, Slow It Down by Benson Boone.
That's getting a video.
And Stick Season by Noah Kahn rebounding to 29. Yeah, I know. That one is still here, apparently. Now that takes us to a largely reasonable list of new arrivals, but unfortunately we have to get it started with number 100, Misses by Dominic Fike.
It's not bad, but like this guy just barely even made a song. This shit's like a minute and 15 seconds.
You know, the further we get away from season 2 of Euphoria, and the more I've been able to comfortably ignore Dominic Fike in general, I've had this hope that going into this, his solid compositional instincts might translate to better songs, especially if there's no real worry of him sticking around long term. But what do you know, Fike's new song is reportedly musing about his past relationship with Hunter Schaefer, go figure. But I'll start with the positive. Fike frames his heartbreak reasonably well. He doesn't blame her for the split. He's trying to be relatively upbeat and jaunty and approachable, almost to an obnoxious degree, because then we get the instrumentation and production, and I swear this entire mix comes out of an indie pop commercial core preset from a decade ago.
Damn.
That faded vocal filter borrowed from American Authors, made all the more grating with some of the old-fashioned vocal harmonies, the washed-out, wheedling melody that I can't stand, the awkward yelping that passes off for a bridge, and the fact that this song can't even reach 90 seconds? I mean, I guess the bass line is fine, but this feels like it's built for a bad commercial, and Dominic Fike's vibes just remain rancid. In other words, I don't like it at all. Next, number 96, Feminine Nomenon by Chapel Roan.
Sigh. It's probably like my least favorite out of the singles that have been, well, not even singles at this point. Like, was Casual. Yeah, no, Casual was a single. I don't know. But, yeah, out of all the songs that charted, it was I don't think I'll ever return to it. Hey, I do like the Papa John reference. Hey, there's been too much hate on Papa John. You know what I'm saying? Well, not the actual guy. That guy's a weirdo. But, like, the pizza place? Too much hate.
Honestly, we're reaching the point with crossover Chapel Roan songs. It just feels like a bonus for me whenever a new one crops up. Even if this isn't one of my favorites, I might prefer Coffee or My Kink is Karma. One of those is a ballad, the other one's an obvious Taylor Swift riff, and this one has blown up across the memes. I'm not exactly surprised. But that's not saying this is bad, far from it. On the contrary, with the fluttery keys and her lilting vocals in the intro, I was almost reminded of 99 Luftballons, a song that I have loved for years, but then that motorbike revs, the bass starts chugging, and the guitars start warping as the beat really kicks up. And I'll admit, the song loses a bit of that vibrancy for me, especially when she brings in the strings and the buzzier synth for the second verse instead of the piano. And then there's a lot of the content, which is juxtaposing the heartbreaking tragedy of struggling to try and find love online with a bunch of fuckboys, in comparison with, say, a more sapphic experience, where I wish I could think of the Papa John's reference without recalling some of the controversy from late 2010.
They're putting cum in the fucking pizza.
And then his response to all this. That is kind of catharsis. But you know what? That's also not Chapel Roan's issue. And she leans into the campy kitsch on the bridge and that final hook. I'm on board regardless. Maybe it's a shade away from great personally for me, but more Chapel Roan is only a positive in my books. I'll take it. Good song. Number 95. Bet. Alibi by Sev Deliza, Pablo Vittar, and Easel.
Stop.
This is more surreal than I expected, and to explain why, we need to go back to 2020, where I first heard of and covered Sev Deliza in an album review on my main channel that largely went unobserved in the On The Pulse series. I was largely lukewarm, largely just wasn't my thing, but I remember observing at the time she was making slight steps towards mainstream crossover, so why not, especially if the song goes viral on TikTok. For those of you who don't know, and I was including myself because I did not recognize the other two people here either, Pablo Vittar is a Brazilian drag queen, Isolt is a French singer-songwriter, and this song is anchored on a prominent sample of a 2000s track from the cumbia artist Toto La Momposina, which creates quite the cultural blend when the song indulges in all the high melodrama, the sex and the murder and the bad romance and the empowerment of dangerous women. In a different era, I think Lady Gaga would try to hop on a remix. I think what gives this a different edge beyond some of the jagged synths and the pummeling bassy Latin groove are the fact that really, Sev Deliza is so much more expressive as a singer. She brings in this smokier, dramatic intensity that balances really well with Isolt's higher cooing and Pablo Vittar's very operatic delivery. It gives the song a grand, swaggering romance that's actually kind of convincing, which we so rarely see in mainstream pop these days, especially stateside. I have no idea if this is gonna last. The cross-section of acts and language might be too much for the U.S. audience, but as someone who was really on the fence about Sev Deliza crossing over,
it's all right.
Yeah, you know what? I was wrong. I'm now convinced. This is legit great. Give it a shot. Check it out. Number 93, Help Me by Real Boston Richie. Yeah, but is that paper got you on to fuck me? Can I keep it real for a second, well, baby? Would you judge me? I can't lie, I ain't been the same since them niggas stuck me. And on the topic of acts I didn't initially recognize, Real Boston Richie is a rapper from Tallahassee, Florida, signed to Future's label, or at least he was. There are rumors of bad blood there, but the song is still under Freebands and Epic. He put out his debut album in 2023, wound up getting some attention, but not a ton of critical hype. So with this new song, yeah, I get why. I gotta be honest, I'm not impressed. Mostly because of Real Boston Richie himself. Yeah, the prominent piano line against the rumbling bass and the thinner skitter of trap percussion, it's catchy enough, but the song doesn't really develop to differentiate that second half of its hook from the verse that would follow it, and that creates that feel of raspy rambling with a sloppier flow than I would personally prefer. But then you get to the content, which is all about trying to find that girl role that might hold him down, help him on his come up, but that sincerity sours very quickly by his complaining that he needs her to have a low body count, and she's playing mind games with him, and by the second verse, after telling her that he's done with all the cheating and she needs to stop crying about it, he will still cheat on her two lines later. I don't care how many cars you buy her, it's clear your priorities and your money aren't in order here. To me, the plea on the hook comes across as really insincere. I know this kind of street life is difficult, but he only seems like he's compounding his own problems, and he's not a good enough rapper or performer in order to sell it and get me to buy in. So yeah, I don't like this either. Let's move on. Number 81, Apple by Charlie XCX. You know, I've gotten used to songs I don't like going viral from albums I otherwise consider good so often that when I actually do appreciate the song that goes viral, it's kind of a nice surprise. So while this is not my favorite from Brat, when So I is right there, that's a deep cut, it's a tribute, it's never gonna cross over, and this is plenty good in the meantime, one of my favorites from the album. Funnily enough, it's a song I did not think of that much when it came to the lyrics, so it's not one that I've revisited so much compared to Sympathy is a Knife or Girl So Confused. But in terms of the existential confusion and deflection at the core of this album, pardon the pun, the metaphor is pretty effective in how she sees the parallel between herself and her parents, some residual anger that she's processing between them, and the worry that she might pass some of that down to the kids that she wants. I mean, it makes the desire for escape feel a bit more desperate, pick up a little bit more pathos there. But I think I like the song more for that fat synth groove and the pulsating bass.
Yeah.
It's just so fire. Tight and efficient, and it reminds me of Crash in the best ways possible. Charlie XCX has highlighted the parallel between this song and Carolyn Polachek, and yeah, I can also hear it, and that's only a positive in my books. So yeah, pretty damn good song. A little bit surprised that this was the newest cut to go viral from Bratz, but I'm not gonna
complain about it
either.
I think it's like a TikTok thing, no?
Number 49,
heard some people talk about it,
like
it's been on
by
TikTok.
Stray Kids. We cannot stop haunting, boom. Ra-ta-ta-ta, I'ma
make it boom, 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 boom. Hey, when it... When I first clicked on the video, I saw freaking Wolverine on the goddamn, like, the first psych. I was like, what? Hey, I don't think it's that bad. Somehow this kind of works for me.
Stray Kids happen. At least on this, Charlie Puth's not here. But okay, apparently the lead single from their newest EP, leaning more on rap and trap percussion with a sharper swagger at the percussion and the buzzy synths and the synth horns across the hook with a lot of gun references. And to be candid, I feel a bit iffy on the framing. K-pop cribbing the dangerous stylism of hip-hop and then divorcing it from any societal context that's heavier, certainly a choice, but this comes across more like action movie posturing than anything that's trying to be all that real, and that really does underscore the arrogance
of
all the flexes.
Well, I can see
on
that
display.
Actually, I can see like this being like kind of like an action movie.
Almost comes across like gloating and trying to go for effortless cool. And to their credit, I'd say they nearly got there on production alone. I actually really like this groove, but I'm still not really impressed by Stray Kids and any of the actual singing or rapping on display. While the boys have different voices, none of them really stick out to me. So yeah, I guess it's okay, but I don't expect it to stick around. Finally, number 14, Who by Jimin.
Bro, is this like actually gonna be like really big? Because like right now, it's like doing really well, especially globally. Like, it's, like, number one global, like, 8 million fucking... Oh, that's a million close to Spotify. Like, 8 million, like, streams and, like, it's like a top three, I think, in U.S., like, streaming-wise. Maybe another 7, maybe.
All right,
maybe like a 7 with
who doesn't know nor
longevity
care enough about K-pop is to say with a response to a song from a BTS member with this title. I mean, outside the army and a subset of pop music critics, I don't know how many folks could tell them apart, just saying. But this song did catch some attention for me, mostly because John Bellion is one of the producers and songwriters, and his record tends to be above average. But yikes, this might not be one of them. Let's start off with the vocal mixing. Why are you pressing Jimin through so many watery layers of auto-tune and pitch correction? He can sing and hit a pretty impressive falsetto. why do this? But that takes to the question of the production in general. With the choppy acoustic guitar, the gleaming pianos, and all the whooshing atmospherics, why does this sound like a lost instrumental from Enrique Iglesias from the year 2000? Now, I'm not against that in principle as a throwback. I liked Enrique and Escape probably more than I should have, but that vibe needs to be airy, groovy, not anchored to bass this thick or a vocal mix this goopy. And the lyrics kind of reinforce that comparison too. The earnest, clean yearning for someone that they don't even know yet but would satisfy one's heart completely, it fits in that boy band 2000s Latin pop playbook. It's not a bad choice. I imagine the world that would work if this wasn't fumbled at the finish line. Hell, maybe live it would work without all the vocal processing, but as a pop song, I guess I don't mind it, but given the pedigree and talent behind it, I don't know, I think it should be better. But yeah, that closes out our week.
I can see that.
The best and the worst, they fall out real fast. In the latter category, might be the obvious pick for me, but Help Me by Real Boston Richie only just edged out Misses by Dominic Fike. But for the best, I would go with Feminine Phenomenon by Chapel Roan, but Alibi by Seb D'Elisa, Pablo Vittar, and Esalt really impressed me. It's getting the top spot with Chapel Roan as honorable mention. I mean, next week, I think we're going to be heading into the summer lull, at least for a bit, but Ice Spice could have some luck here. We'll have to see how the streaming comes out, or if we get an album bomb. Again, stay tuned. But until then, I'm Mark. You're watching Billboard Breakdown.
We're going to see him next time. All right, guys. That's Billboard Breakdown. Pretty okay week. Not bad. I didn't think Mrs. was okay. It's just, like, really fucking short. Everything here wasn't even that bad, honestly. Maybe except the Help Me song. That shit was pretty mid, I can't lie. But yeah, everything here, yeah, not bad. Yeah, not a bad week. Guys, go subscribe to Boober Breakdown. Go subscribe to Spectrum Post on every single platform ever made. And subscribe to me, and yeah, thanks for watching.